They are skillful.
Hello, art family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. I decided to go back to doing some gouache because I got an overwhelming amount of requests for it online. My life's been in a bit of an upheaval. We've been traveling a lot, and we moved and, you know, had to sell one house, buy another house, and so I've been traveling a lot, and it's just easier to keep my watercolor gear with me and do sketches on the fly that way, so. But I'm happy to get back into doing some more gouache videos and talking about gouache. Part of why I chose this particular subject is it's not my most commonly used saw, but it's definitely my favorite, I think. And I was inspired by one of my favorite YouTube channels, which if I'm not watching a painting video, I'm usually watching The Essential Craftsman. And it's just a great channel for overall wisdom and inspiration and tips on woodworking. But my life is finally settling down. I renovated my studio space up in Pittsburgh. Here's a look at my workspace now. It's nice to finally have some room, because I don't know if you noticed in old videos, but I was doing most of my work on a kitchen table from a year ago. Let's get started. I start out the sketch by doing a light pencil sketch of the subject. In this case, I kind of took it a little too far. I think I was having to chip the rust off a little bit from all the travel. One of the main things I wanted to talk about in this video is a technique that I've come to call a cotton candy underpainting. Usually I just go with like a yellow ochre or a cool color as an underpainting, just one coat to get rid of the white, or leave some white if I want to, but I picked up a little lesson from Peter Chan or Pixel P Chan's videos. I don't think this is proprietary because he's quoting someone, but he mentions if you're a dull painter, which I am, then you should start with really bright colors as an underpainting, and if you paint really bright and colorful, you should start with a dull underpainting. So here I'm working in an underpainting, and I'm just using like bright pink, yellow ochre, cobalt blue, and some purple, like lavender colors, and I'm just getting a kind of, you know, a cotton candy mashup of all these different colors that I can start building the value on top of, and that way, once the image is done, even though you'll see as I go, every layer gets a little bit less and less water and the paint gets thicker and thicker, but you can kind of see in the thinner areas where the paint gets thin, that bottom layer shining through just a little bit, which just gives it like a nice touch of color. So there's some areas where you can see little bits of pink and some areas you see little hints of lavender or cool colors, and it just gives like a nice little kind of subtle touch of color, especially for someone like me who tends to paint very, very dull. Which is sort of a problem I've had to work through, which is that I tend to paint very, very dull or muddy. I usually paint by temperature mainly anyway, so I usually don't pay that much attention to the color I'm choosing, if that makes sense. But instead, try to focus on a gray, usually burnt sienna and ultramarine, and then I just pitch that in a temperature direction, so that either cool or warm, and then build volume and shape from there. Always considering, of course, the local color and the effect that light is having on it. I decided to take some time to focus on building the form of this bright, red, beautiful handle. And it's very, very red, and I think one thing I'm trying to make sure I do is keep the red very vibrant, because in the areas of the shadow, light is still getting in there and bouncing around, so you're having red bounce off of red. So in the darker spots, you're still getting really, really bright reds because light's getting in there and bouncing around. And I'm also trying to consider the fact that I have basically a warm light coming from one direction, and then the cool light is flooding in from the window outside the workshop. This is my main technique for applying gouache, is basically get your drawing in, get your underpainting in to get rid of the white, so you're right in the middle on the value, or towards the lighter end of the value, and then just start to build form. So apply the rules that you know about light. I have other videos on that if you're interested, but apply the rules you know to light. So If you're going towards a warmer light, you know, increase the saturation, add some yellow ochre, or brighten the color. If you're going away, cool down in the shadows. If you've got a cool light, I would shoot for warm shadows. If you've got a warm light, I would shoot for cool shadows. Always try to keep a constant transition from warm to cool. So even if you don't experience it specifically, it's a natural phenomenon that's happening constantly. And if you add that to your paintings, it'll give a real sense of the object really being there. If you can just do subtle hints of pitching from warm to cool, especially in the shadows. I don't know if you noticed, but the main way I'm building these shapes is I'm focusing on the biggest shape first, the biggest shapes of light and of shadow, and then I'm sort of subdividing from there. And I go ahead and I pop in some darker shadows just to kind of, you know, give myself some map points to move around the image and the object and not lose the drawing. So some definite cast shadows help to sort of give you structure to hang the rest of your form building on top of. But outside of that, it's a lot of just subdividing. So you focus on the big, big shape, get yourself a nice color. And here I'm focusing, I've got this cool light on the top and light's bouncing, the warm light that's facing it is hitting the wood table and bouncing back up into the bottom of the object. And that's something I notice. So I'm trying here to build a definite shadow, but a warm shadow on the bottom where the light is bouncing off the table and up into the object, especially on metal that's shiny and it's going to pick up a whole lot of light activity. So as I go, I'm building these shapes and I'm using less and less water as I go, until basically the last couple layers I do on an image are almost completely impasto or whatever. It's just thick paint, like scooped out and globbed on. And one thing you also might take note of is the fact that I'm using about a 1 inch, it might be 3/4 inch, but I'm using the fattest flat brush I have. And I'm going to use that for almost the whole image, just as much as I can do. I try to use that one because it keeps me from being able to get into noodling into the details, because I've done so many sketches where I get going, I get real excited about something like the handle, and I just detail the fire out of it, and then the drawing is wrong, or something's off, and now I have a really nice handle and a terrible painting. And so, in order to focus on the whole image, and again, the biggest shapes first before subdividing into the smaller shapes, I try to use the biggest brush I have for as much of the image as possible. And then once I get into the smaller parts, I can use smaller brushes or even a round brush to sort of get in details. But I'm not terribly interested in the details. I'm very interested in the fat chunks of color and how this form is constructed. So now that I have the main chunks of shapes, I'm going to start to do the negative painting or the background, if you want to call it that. But my focus here is not yet to work on the tool belt or the little can of wood stain that I have next to it, but I'm trying to fix the drawing. That's all I care about right now, is transitioning, as you can see, from warm to cool. So we get some blues, you get some yellow ochres or burnt siennas, and get like a nice subtle transition of color. But my main thing is I want to use the shadow and I want to use the background value. So if I close my eyes and squint, I notice it's slightly darker than the highlights on the handle and the object, parts of the object. So okay, I know I'm going to knock that down because I want to also paint on top of the underpainting and I want to fix the value. But my main goal is I want to just nudge the painting, just fix the drawing. I notice that the disc of the blade was off slightly, the handle was a little bit fatter than it should be, and so I'm using the shadow, I'm using the background, which is your best option for correcting the drawing. So I can just sort of kiss the edges and nudge it into a better shape, a closer shape to the image I'm trying to paint. And now just to get rid of the rest of the underpainting, I'm going to start building in the tool bags behind it. So it's a yellow ochre leather object, and I notice that the value of it is darker than the blade itself. So I want to keep it yellow ochre, but I also want to pitch it darker and continue transitioning from warm to cool. And just in case you're totally new to painting, I know when I was new to painting, if someone said warm to cool, I would have just been totally perplexed. Warm basically being your oranges and your kind of reds, and cools being your blues. So when you're transitioning from warm to cool, you want to consider it within the grays, transitioning from bluish colors to orangish colors. I'm trying to add yellow to this framing square, this little speed square I have, because it's translucent, so light gets trapped inside of it and it sort of glows. But I'm not terribly interested in the tape measure chunk or the tool bag or even the little can I'm working on right now of wood stain, because I don't want them to take away from the saw, because my main goal is to paint this saw. So I'm trying to keep those shapes not subdivided, just big fat chunks. Like you can kind of see on the little leather tape measure holder thing above the saw, I kept it in just fat chunks. What's the light chunk? What's the darker chunk? And how can I slightly transition it from warm to cool? Again, I know you're probably tired of hearing me say that, but using that to just create something that's in the background is just big fat chunks of color. And same with the can. And I'm gonna try to do that with the wood also in the background, is just keep it all sort of subtle chunks and then continue to subdivide the saw to smaller and smaller pieces. I realize some of the advice about color and applying color is probably redundant for a lot of people who've been painting for a little while, but for me, I'm trying to give people advice who've never painted before. Like when I started, I had never painted before. I wanted to work in comics. I had no interest in painting. And so I had a friend who painted, and I asked him for some advice, and he just kind of basically told me that I would never be a painter because I just didn't have the eyes for it. If I didn't see the color that he was saying he saw, then he just didn't know what to tell me, that there was basically no solution to it. But I can tell you that it is something you can learn, and there are rules and laws that there are great resources for. Of course, James Gurney, everybody knows James Gurney and his book Color and Light, that can explain things. And really, it's kind of like sensors. Once you start turning on these sensors, like warm and cool, and these color sensors, you start picking up these subtle things. I talk about that a lot in the video about painting a white house. What I'm doing right now, which looks like I'm just swatting at it, is something gouache really shines at, is I'm taking some plain water with nothing in it, and then just lightly touching the edges where the two different colors meet. And if you do it just subtly enough, you can get the colors to blend in gouache. Now, if you go too heavy-handed, you will wipe it all the way back down to the white of the paper. That's sort of the strength and weakness of gouache. I'm going to show something in a minute about what I do with these sketches when I'm done with them, because it's always good to seal your sketch if you're happy with your sketch. And a lot of them, if I don't care about it, I'll leave it exposed, because then you can just wipe it off with a rag and start all over. But if I'm happy with a sketch, or even in my sketchbook, I'll take it outside and hit it with some fixative. And I don't know if you noticed, but I'd say I think on this one, I probably bailed too early on it, but I made it at least, I want to say, a solid 90% before switching to a small round brush, and that was mostly because I had to noodle in these tiny letters. But I tried to stick with the big brush as long as possible. I always do that. And that's for painting across the board. If it's oil or gouache or watercolor, I always stick to the biggest, fattest brush I have for as long as possible. And now what I'm trying to work out is the value is not working to what I'm seeing, which sort of looks crazy at first, but there's a cool light coming into the workshop from behind the saw, and it's hitting the surface of the wood, and it's making it very, very light in certain portions. So the front of the wood is kind of warm, and then the back is this sort of white light that's pouring in and just grazing the top. But I really wanted to have that, because if you skip back, you can see that the red sort of gets lost amongst the muck of the table, but this light passing through is a great opportunity to give an overlap of light and dark. So Again, with the tool bag, you know, you have a darker tool bag, lighter saw, and here we have the darker handle against the lighter light. When you have a chance to expose things like that, use them to your advantage. Pay attention for dark and light overlaps, because that really sells the three dimension of an object. So all that's left at this point is my favorite part, to take off the tape. I decided to mail this to the Essential Craftsman guy, so I'm going to spray it with a workable fixative just to seal in the painting, so that if it ever does get wet or something touches it, the paint won't just run off back to the white of the paper. That's a crescent board, by the way, that I was working on. Crescent 101, I think, illustration board. And that's it for this demonstration. I hope you found something helpful. I'm going to try to stick to doing some more gouache here and there, because I had a lot of people request that. So thank you all the new subscribers, and thank you everyone who's been so kind and so supportive, and I really appreciate it. So in the meantime, good luck out there, and happy sketching.